highest order of business before the nation is to restore our economic prosperity.
In 1981, President Ronald Reagan chose as Treasury Secretary the CEO of the investment bank Merrill Lynch, Donald Regan.
Wall Street and the president do see eye to eye. I've talked to many leaders of Wall Street. They all say we're behind the president 100%.
He took the key position of Treasury Secretary so he could enact the tax cuts that the rich wanted.
Then they should give the president what 43 governors have, a line item veto. And
Who tells the president to speed it up?
It is not the president that makes the decision in this country. It's the Secretary of Treasury.
The man from Merrill Lynch, that's who. Things in America would never be the same again. The country would now be run like a corporation.
We're going to turn the bull loose.
The Reagan administration, supported by economists and financial lobbyists, started a 30-year period of financial deregulation. In 1982, the Reagan administration deregulated savings and loan companies, allowing them to make risky investments with their depositors' money.
4 years later, when Reagan ran for re-election, it was all smiley faces and happy talk.
We're on the upward swing, and the factories are working much stronger than before.
We're back on top.
What Reagan presided over was the wholesale dismantling of our industrial infrastructure. This was not done to save money or remain competitive, as companies back then were already posting record earnings in the billions. No, it was done for short-term profits. And to destroy the unions. Millions of people were thrown out of work.
By the end of the decade, hundreds of savings and loan companies had failed. This crisis cost taxpayers $124 billion and cost many people their life savings.
It may be the biggest bank heist in our history.
Thousands of savings and loan executives went to jail for looting their companies.
The 1980s also saw an innovation that would forever change how lending decisions were made, with FICO's launch of its first general-purpose credit bureau score.
As for Alan Greenspan, President Reagan appointed him chairman of America's central bank, the Federal Reserve. Greenspan was reappointed by Presidents Clinton and George W. Bush. During the Clinton administration, deregulation continued under Greenspan, and Treasury Secretaries Robert Rubin, the former CEO of the investment bank Goldman Sachs, and Larry Summers, a Harvard economics professor.
There were two more innovations in the 1990s that transformed business decisions. One was the development of FICO Falcon Fraud Manager, which detects credit card fraud using neural networks. It's said to be the most successful commercial use of artificial intelligence ever. And the other key technology was decision rules management. And FICO's award-winning Blaze Advisor became the most powerful rules management system when it launched in 1998, giving businesses a fast, flexible way to govern the rules behind their business decisions.
By the late 1990s, the financial sector had consolidated into a few gigantic firms, each of them so large that their failure could threaten the whole system. And the Clinton administration helped them grow even larger. In 1998, Citicorp and Travelers merged to form Citigroup, the largest financial services company in the world. The merger violated the Glass-Steagall Act, a law passed after the Great Depression, which prevented banks with consumer deposits from engaging in risky investment banking activities. In 1999, at the urging of Summers and Rubin, Congress passed the Graham-Leach-Bliley Act, known to some as the Citigroup Relief Act. It overturned Glass-Steagall and cleared the way for future mergers.
Why do you have big banks? Well, because banks like monopoly power, because banks like lobbying power, because banks know that when they're too big, they will be bailed.
Markets are inherently unstable, or at least potentially unstable. And appropriate metaphor is the oil tankers. They're very big, and therefore you have to put in compartments to prevent the sloshing around of oil from capsizing the boat. The design of the boat has to take that into account. And after the depression, the regulations actually introduced these very watertight compartments. And deregulation has led to the end of compartmentalization.
The next crisis came at the end of the 90s. The investment banks fueled a massive bubble in internet stocks, which was followed by a crash in 2001 that caused $5 trillion in investment losses. The Securities and Exchange Commission, the federal agency which had been created during the Depression to regulate investment banking, had done nothing. The investment banks had promoted internet companies they knew would fail. Stock analysts were being paid based on how much business they brought in, and what they said publicly was quite different from what they said privately.
InfoSpace, given the highest possible rating, dismissed by an analyst as a piece of junk. Excite, also highly rated, called such a piece of crap.
If money is evil, then that building is hell. This is the most obnoxious group of money-hungry, low IQ, high energy, jackrabbit, fucking wannabe, big time, small time, shit talking, bothersome, irritating bunch of motherfuckers I have ever had to endure for more than 5 minutes.
Since deregulation began, the world's biggest financial firms have been caught laundering money, defrauding customers, and cooking their books again and again. And again.
Taking care of business every day. Taking care of business every way. I've been taking care of business. It's all mine.
Credit Suisse helped funnel money for Iran's nuclear program and for the Aerospace Industries Organization of Iran, which builds ballistic missiles.
Any information that would identify it as Iranian would be removed.
The bank was fined $536 million. Citibank helped funnel $100 million of drug money out of Mexico.
Did you comment that she should, quote, lose any documents connected with the account?
I said that in a kidding manner. It was at the early stages of this. I did not mean it seriously.
Between 1998 and 2003, Fannie Mae overstated its earnings by more than $10 billion. When UBS was caught helping wealthy Americans evade taxes, they refused to cooperate with the U.S. government.
Would you be willing to supply the names?
If there's a treaty framework...
No treaty framework. You've agreed you participated in a fraud. Mm.
But while the companies face unprecedented fines, the investment firms do not have to admit any wrongdoing.
I got a job waiting for my graduation. $50,000 a year, we'll buy a lot of beer. Things are going great, and they're only getting better. I'm doing all right, getting good grades. My future's so bright, I gotta wear shades. With x-ray eyes, things are going great, and they're only getting better. Well, I'm doing all right, getting good grades, my future's so bright. I gotta wear shades, I gotta wear shades.